The argument between string people and loop people, which unbelievably we still have going on, is a translation problem for her.
What does that mean?
They're both right in different regimes. And
yeah, I recall reading one of your books, forgive me that I don't know the name, because there are several, and in one of them you mentioned that you believe loop quantum gravity to be a subset of string theory. Or no, you said there was a duality between them.
Yes, but I know that's way too simplified.
Okay. Yeah, and you used the word duality, that there is a duality between them. And I don't know if you used that word poetically or if you meant that mathematically there's a duality.
There are theories which are dual to each other. And for example, one of them is you can take electromagnetism and you can look at its phase with the magnetic field frozen. That means that magnetic field expresses itself by making magnetic field lines discrete. And so then you have a phase of electromagnetism where magnetic field lines are discrete. You have a phase where neither field lines are discrete. That's the usual behavior of electromagnetic fields. And then you can go into a dual to the magnetic field lines frozen, to where you can go into a dual of the phase where the magnetic field lines are frozen to a phase where the electric field lines are frozen. And that's what in the phase where electric field lines are frozen, you have confinement.
Mm-hmm.
And the confinement is represented by the frozen electric field lines, which means that there's a cost in energy per length of the electric field line. And that's why the quarks behave in a way which is confined.
Yes.
And we believe that that's the way that non-being engaged fields behave when they represent the gravitational field.
So that would be an example of a duality.
Loop quantum gravity.
Okay.
Being dual to a field theory of gravity.
Uh-huh.
Which is described by general relativity.
Is this another way of saying that there's a translation issue, that they describe different regimes, or this is a different phenomenon?
I don't know. But it's a way of explaining what happens in loop quantum gravity.
Ed Witten was once asked, recently actually, in the past 5 years, what about other approaches to quantum gravity, other than string theory? And he said, what other approaches?
Right, of course he would.
And then they listed some, like causal sets or loop quantum gravity. And then he said, well, the reason why string theory is supreme is because the mathematics of those are described in string theory, or tend to be more and more. String theory tends to gobble up, whereas those don't tend to gobble string theory. So he said, if there's something to loop quantum gravity, I'm sure we'll discover it in string theory as well.
They already have a long time ago.
Well, can you explain that? And what do you make of that statement overall? I was paraphrasing, so please don't quote me on that.
Oh, that's okay. I mean, what am I supposed to hire? His father was a good friend of my mother's. And
Lewis Witten.
Lewis Witten, yes. And I think, I don't know. I here's something I realized recently. Ed used to give me advice. Edward used to give me advice. And I used to misunderstand it because I was too oversensitive to being criticized, and especially by him. For example, he would come to me and tell me, when I was a graduate student, he would say, you know, you really ought to have a research program and develop it. And I said, but Edward, I have a research program, but he never was interested in mine. That's the way it felt. Well, not recently, but maybe 20 years ago, I was for a day at the Institute. I gave a talk and so forth. And he came over to me and he said, I have some advice for you. And I said, sure, what? And he said, you know, you're really smarter than you look. And for people to become convinced of how smart you are, you should get out of quantum gravity for a while and work on condensed matter theory. Because there are a lot of people who are working on interesting problems, and people will get to see how smart you are. Now, I heard that as criticism.
Okay.
But I think he was actually trying to give me what would have been if I couldn't have taken it because I'm interested in condensed matter theory. I'm interested in applying ideas from condensed matter theory to loop quantum gravity, and that would be one way to explain to Edward what we're doing. But I took it as a strong criticism, whereas I'm sure he meant it kindly as advice.
Mm-hmm.
And so we all evolve. Anyway, I know what Edward is trying to say. I think the reverse is true. And I think there are a lot of results related to loop Hamming gravity, mathematical results, that if he took the time to learn, he would see what their purpose was in string theory. And I don't like to talk about string theory and loop quantum gravity. I would rather talk about background independent and background dependent.
Sure.
Because I'm sure that they're the same theory.
There are background independent approaches to string theory, though.
I don't know. I mean, that work, but please, show me one.
There are some talks that I saw, and I can send you over email. Recently, in the past 2 years, I'm sure they're of limited applicability, like it's just for type 2B.
Right. If it's ADS-CFT, it's hard for me to be interested.
Mm-hmm.
Because that has a background on it.
Yes.
By definition. And it doesn't allow me to ask the questions that I want to ask.
So Feynman was extremely concerned with appearing intellectual or appearing smart. And one of the, like, he talks about this, he likes to trick people into them thinking that he's brighter than he is by memorizing large sums or cracking safes and so on. And Gell-Mann, I think, criticized him for this, said, Feynman, you focus on the marketing of Feynman and not the physics, like focus more on the physics. As you age, insecurities tend to dissipate. Maybe other ones creep up, I don't know.
Yeah, they certainly do in my case.
Yeah. What were your insecurities when you were younger? And
well, they mostly related to women, this.
Yeah, as they do, right? Yeah. You know Jonathan Oppenheim?
Sure.
What do you make of his stochastic gravity approach?
I like some of it, but I don't believe if he had, there's a part of it, now maybe he's giving this up, but there's a part of it where he says that gravity is classical. And although I don't believe that gravity is quantum mechanical, mm-hmm. I don't believe that gravity is classical either.
Mm-hmm. You believe it's a third option?
Yes, the third option is that space doesn't exist, time exists and is fundamental, and space and space-time emerge from the fundamental world, which is basically a fancy version of causal sets. And we can show how our fancy version of causal sets allows space-time to emerge
mm-hmm.
in a way that lets there be, in the emergent level, something like general relativity, but only at the emergent level.
If you enjoyed that clip, then the full podcast is out right now. You can click around here. Enjoy. Subscribe to Theories of Everything to get notified of upcoming podcasts, as there are new full-length podcasts every week on the topics of mathematics, physics, consciousness, free will, and AI.